again, for families that are new to us, we do have a children's church ministry. You're more than welcome to have your children sit in with you during service. But if you'd like to take your children, there's a children's church happening during this time as well. Well, do you know, during Jesus' entire lifetime, he always spoke blessing. He spoke life. He spoke heaven's truth from heaven, and the people were amazed at his teaching. He spoke life into a storm. Remember the storm and the threatening of the lives of the disciples on the boat? And he spoke and said, "Peace, be still." And he spoke blessing. He spoke life into chaos and death. He spoke life to a paralyzed man. He said, "Your sins are forgiven. Get up, go home." And the man walked up healed and forgiven. He ran across a man who was filled with a legion of demons, and he spoke life and freedom into that man. And he said, "Come out of him, you demons, and go into the pigs." And he spoke life. He spoke life to blind Bartimaeus. He said, "Receive your sight." And he spoke life into a blind man. He spoke life into Jairus' daughter, 12 years old, this young daughter, but she had died. And he spoke life to her and said, "Little girl, arise," and she comes to life again. In every situation, in every circumstance, Jesus speaks blessing. Jesus speaks life. Except for one time. Did you realize there's one time recorded where Jesus actually speaks a curse? And he speaks death. You say, what? That's so out of character for Jesus. Why would the one who speaks blessing, who speaks life, the author of blessing, the author of life, the giver of blessing, the giver of life, why would he speak a curse? Why would he speak death? Well, there's a reason he does it. We're going to see what that reason is this morning. He has a powerful lesson for your life and for my life about what it means to be a follower of Jesus. He has a powerful lesson. In fact, there is a fruit he wants to see in your life and in my life that comes out of this event where he actually speaks a curse and speaks death. Do you know the event I'm talking about? It's recorded in Mark's chapter 11. We're going to read that together, where Jesus actually speaks. It's shocking. It's so out of character. It ought to grab our attention because it's unlike Jesus in so many ways. But it's a powerful, again, lesson in what it means to follow Jesus, and particularly what he is seeking, the fruit. There's an essential fruit he's seeking in your life and in my life. Before we read the passage, I want to show you a couple of pictures, because it's about the fig tree. And most of us don't know a fig about fig trees. But let me show you a picture, if we can put it up on screen. That's the temple. Let's see the fig tree. If we can see, the fig tree has, there we go. If you look at this picture of a fig tree, you'll see the big ripe fig, okay? It's almost ready. It's not quite ripe. It turns sort of a purple color before you pick it and eat it. But see the buds. This is what I want you to see. See the buds, the little buds on the top of that. That's going to be important, because there's a puzzling thing in this passage that we need to see. The fig fruit, but the fig buds. Okay, that'll help understand the passage. And then the second picture, the temple, if we can go back to that. I want us to see, this is a model of the temple, Herod's temple in Jesus' day. And the tall building in the middle, that's the Holy of Holies. That's the place where God's residence was. And around that is the courts of the Jewish courts, the priestly courts. And there was a men's and a women's court. What I want you to recognize, the external courts, the larger courts, that's where Jesus is going to throw out the money changers. It's in the Gentile courts and in the outer courts, and I want you to have a visual of that, because what we're going to see in this passage, where Jesus speaks this shocking curse of death, is what happens is, as Mark tells a story led by the Holy Spirit, he tells it in a way that says these two things are related. The fig tree and the temple, they're related. And the way he does that, it's a literary device. If you study literature, Holy Spirit uses it. It's called inclusio, is the technical term, where he goes from one scene A to the other scene B, then back to the same scene A. And it's a way of saying these two are tied together. They're related together. So as Mark tells the story, he says, here's the fig tree, here's the temple, oh yeah, and back to the fig tree. And why does he do that? Because these things are related together. And we're going to see how they're related together. And so let's be aware of that as we read through the passage, the shocking passage where Jesus actually speaks a curse. The one time ever that he speaks a curse. And it's in Mark's chapter 11. The text says this: the next day, as Jesus and his disciples were leaving Bethany, Jesus was hungry, fully God, fully man. And in his humanity, he was like you and me. He got hungry. Don't go on too long, Pastor Rick. Lunch is coming. I don't want to get hungry, right? Hopefully you had a good breakfast, but that's part of our humanity. Seeing in the distance a fruit tree, Jesus, and here it is, the fig tree. Scene A is the fig tree. Seeing the fig tree, and Mark notices it's in leaf. It's got foliage. He went to find if it had any fruit. It's a fruit tree. You expect to get fruit from a fruit tree, right? And he's hungry. He wants to eat that fruit. When he reached it, he found nothing. It's barren. But leaves. It had leaves. It had foliage, but it had no fruit. Because it was not the season for figs. Now, that's a little bit puzzling. Why would Jesus go and look for figs on a tree that it wasn't the season for figs? I'm tempted to say, because of my Portuguese background, it's like the Portuguese that went to look for a mango, but it wasn't a mango season, right? Why would he do that? Well, the answer to that, if you knew about fig trees, is that's why I showed you the picture, that before the actual fruit comes out, there's these little buds, these little pre-figs. And it was very common for poor people to eat those figs. They were edible. They weren't very tasty. It wasn't the ripe fruit. But apparently that's what Jesus did. Even though it wasn't the season for figs, he would have expected and people would have got it. He's just going to eat the initial buds. But here's the point. He finds it barren. There's nothing. There's no fruit. This is where the shocking part comes. Jesus is hungry and there's no fruit. And he speaks a curse. He speaks death on this tree. You'd expect him, it's an empty tree, and maybe you'd say, be fruitful, fig tree, and do a miracle and provide fruit for my lunch and my disciples. I mean, on other cases, he fed people, right? That's what he did. Not on this occasion. What does he do? He speaks a curse, and this is the shocking part. Then he said to the tree, may no one ever eat fruit from you again. May no one ever eat fruit from... He speaks a curse. And his disciples heard him say it. It's like, yeah, this isn't quite like Jesus. That's not normally what he does. Okay? Fig tree, now it goes to the temple. And Mark is saying these two things are related. On reaching Jerusalem, Jesus entered the temple courts. And we showed you a picture of that. The external courts, the Gentile courts. And began driving out those who were buying and selling there. Now, in the Jewish courts and the inner courts, Gentile people could not go in there. The only place that Gentiles had to go and offer their praises, offer their worship, was in these external courts. But the temple had become like a marketplace, like an oriental bazaar, and all of these businesses were happening, and yeah, there was money changing, and there were, you know, if you were going to offer a sacrifice in Jerusalem, then you would want to not haul your sheep all the way from Galilee, but you'd go down to Jerusalem, and you'd buy a sheep and offer it at Passover, whatever. So there was business, but it had been taken over as a marketplace, and I imagine it kind of like back in the day at the Aloha Stadium, they used to have flea markets, right? And it's like you go up and the only place you have to worship God, and there's flea markets all the way around. You're trying to offer your praise and prayer to God, and people are doing business. And it was a mess, and it was corrupt. And that's Jesus entered the temple courts. He began to drive out those who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves and would not allow anyone to carry merchandise through the temple courts. In other words, Jesus took over the temple. And this is huge. Now, if you've ever read this passage, you might have think, you know, it's kind of like, oh, Jesus went to church. He went to the temple. He went and he took over. There is a huge thing going on here because the temple wasn't just church. The temple was the centerpiece of Israel's faith and religion. It was, I imagine, it was the political, religious, financial center of the nation. It was, if you put all of these things together, this was the temple. If you put the Vatican for the Catholic Church, sort of the center of the worldwide religion, okay, of the worldwide Catholic, take the Vatican, and all of the religious power of that. Take Wall Street, all of the financial power of the U.S., because the financial power was centered in the temple too. And then add to that the White House, all of the political power. You add all of the political power of the nation under Rome. You take all of the financial power, all of the, and you put it in one place. That's the temple. Jesus went in there and he took charge. He took authority. And no wonder we'll see the religious leaders were not pleased with that. And ultimately, as you read the story of the Gospels, that's what led to his crucifixion. He's taking on all of the powers of the nation. He's coming into the temple and he's taking charge. And that's what's going. And here's his heart. He taught them, is it not written, my house, God's house, the temple of Israel, is to be called a house of prayer, a house where people connect with God for all the nations. It's not just the Jewish nation. It's just not Israel. It's all the nations. That was God's heart for the temple. All of the nations had access into his presence, and yet they had turned the place for Gentile worship into a marketplace. So when he says, you have made it a den of robbers, think about that. Yeah, I'm sure there was some financial corruption going on. When you go and you never buy a gift in an airport, right? Because you're going to get scalped. And there was some scalping going on, excessive, but far more than financial corruption, and far more even than turning a house of prayer into a marketplace. God is being robbed, and Gentiles are being robbed, because this was a place where Gentiles had access to God in prayer and praise. And God was being robbed of his rightful worship and praise and prayer and Gentiles. This was corruption spiritually as well as corruption. I mean, it was a terrible mess, and that's why Jesus went in and he declared God's heart. God's heart was for this to be a connection place for all people to God. And he took charge. So it goes from there. It goes from fig tree to the temple and Jesus taking charge. And the chief priests and the teachers of the law heard this. They began looking for a way to kill him. The religious leadership of the house of God, the Messiah comes into his house. And they not only reject him, they're seeking to murder him. Because their political power, their religious power, their financial power is being threatened by Jesus' ministry to the people. It says, because the whole crowd, everyone in that temple, was amazed at his teaching. When evening came, Jesus and his disciples went out of the city. Okay, so A, fig tree. B, temple. Now we go back to the fig tree. In the morning, as they went along, they saw, guess what? The fig tree. Captured this, it's dead. Withered from the roots. Now think about that. You don't have to be a gardener to realize if you got a tree and it starts withering from the branches, what do? You water it and it comes back to life. But if it's withered from the roots, it's done. It's dead. You can't recover if it's withered from the roots. That's the source of its life. The point is a very clear picture. And just the day before he'd spoken this curse, may no one ever eat from you. The next day it's dead. Peter remembered and said to Jesus, Rabbi, look, the fig tree you cursed. You spoke death over that thing and it's dead. And again, this is shocking. This is Jesus speaking a curse of death over this tree. And he says this. Jesus, and please note this, he says, have faith in God. Have faith. Now, he's surely saying more to Peter and his disciples than, don't you have enough faith that I can kill a tree? I mean, he had done huge miracles and they'd seen him. So it's not just have faith in this miracle. He is saying that he is looking for faith in his disciples. He says, have faith in God. And then he goes on to teach them about faith. And he teaches them several things about faith. He says, truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in their heart, but believes, that's faith, that what they say will happen, it will be done for them. He teaches them about faith. And then he says again, therefore I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. He's teaching them about faith. And he says a third thing. And when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, as you stand praying and connecting with God in faith, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. So what's going on here? Why does the Holy Spirit through Mark tell us about ABA? How are these two things related? And what is the essential fruit that Jesus is looking for in our lives as disciples? Well, you probably figured it out, but you see, the temple, the fig tree, was an object lesson. It was a physical picture, a physical portrayal of what was going on spiritually in the temple. That's why how the two were related. The fig tree is a physical object lesson of the spiritual reality of the temple. And here's what's going on. Jesus comes into the temple, and it has all of the foliage of religion. Think about it. The fig tree and leaf. It has all the promise of religion. I mean, you go into the temple, that was the centerpiece. That's where the teaching of the law was. That's where the offerings were. That's where the celebrations, where the praise, where the priesthood. It was all of the external foliage of religion. And Jesus is looking for a fruit. And he's looking for the fruit of faith. But there's no fruit there. It's barren. Just like that fig tree. It had all the foliage of religion. But he was looking for hearts of faith, and he found it barren. And the evidence in the temple that it was barren spiritually, it had all the external foliage of religion, but it did not have the fruit of faith, and it's demonstrated in the way that they had abused what and corrupted what the purpose of the temple was spiritually, to be a house of prayer for God, and they had lost that, and the religious leaders were in charge of that. But not only that, the religious leaders were rejecting the very Messiah, the Son of God, who was coming into his house. And it was corrupt, and Jesus spoke judgment on the temple. And by the way, here's a picture of it. If you keep reading the gospel records in Mark's gospel, chapter 13, Jesus explicitly pronounces judgment on the temple and says it's going to be destroyed. And within that generation, by 70 AD, the Romans totally destroyed the temple. So if you go, it's never been rebuilt. If you go to Jerusalem today, it's only the foundation stones that are there at the Jewish most sacred place, the Western Wall, where Jewish people go up and pray, and Christians are welcome to join them as well. But the point is this: Jesus pronounced judgment on the temple, and it was destroyed. And in speaking a curse on this fig tree, it was just an object lesson of what he was going to do explicitly. But here's the point. The temple was an artificial facade. Jesus was looking for authentic faith. And you know, that's a powerful truth for our lives too. If Jesus happened to just walk by and look at New Hope Kailua, he could see all the external stuff of religion. He could see a pastor preaching the word of God. He could see people singing hymns and choruses and worship. He could see people serving children. He could see all of this religious stuff going on. And it's all good stuff. But what he's looking for is he's looking for hearts of faith. He's looking for the fruit of faith. And that's why he teaches his disciples about faith. He could go into your house, into my home, and he could see all this external stuff that looks like faith. We sang a wonderful song this morning, the song about, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. He could walk into your home, and he might see, you know, the praying hands picture on the wall. That's a beautiful thing. Or he might see a little, a placard on your home that says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. You might even be wearing a t-shirt that says, he is greater than I. You might have a Bible sitting on your desk stand or Christian books on your shelves. And those are all good things. You might even have a bumper sticker in your car that says, honk if you love Jesus. And he would see all of those external things, but what he really wants to see in our lives is a heart of faith, the fruit of faith, authentic faith, the real thing that operates all of those things. It's been a few years now, but Coca-Cola used to have that ad that says, Coke, the real thing, Coca-Cola, the real thing, as opposed to fake things. Jesus is looking for the real thing in our lives, and the real thing is faith. He's looking for disciples, for followers, and that's why he stops and he takes this teachable moment with Peter and his disciples. He says, let me teach you about faith. This is what I'm looking for in the temple. This is why Mark tells us a story of how these are two related. He's looking for spiritual fruit in our lives, and that fruit is the fruit of faith. So what does authentic faith look like? Let me suggest to you three things that Jesus points out right here. Pastor Rick didn't make these up. Jesus says, this is what my disciples need to know about faith. Here's a little message about faith. Number one, authentic faith. What does it do? How does it show up in our lives? It trusts God without wavering. It trusts God without wavering. Jesus said, he says in verse 23, truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, now what's he talking about moving mountains? I don't think God is that interested in removing the coal. He's talking about things that are God things, obstacles in the way, things that take miraculous power, things that you and I cannot do. You and I cannot move a mountain. It's a God thing. It's a miracle. And in some ways, it's an obstacle. And he says, if you believe in God, if you trust him without wavering. Did you catch that? If anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea and does not doubt in their heart. In other words, they believe steadfastly. They believe resolutely. They believe unwaveringly, not flipping, flopping, and weakly. He's looking for a faith that trusts God without wavering. That's one sign of an authentic faith. And when I think about, well, I would ask you, what are you trusting God for in your life that you are just unwavering for? A God thing, something that only God can do that you are not capable of doing. And that's the kind of faith he's looking for. What are you trusting him for right now that is a God thing? I can think of several things in my mind. I thought about it last week. One of our blessings in our history here at our church family was when we planted New Hope Kailua, we started meeting in the community center right next to the swimming pool. We were glad for a facility and we felt led by the Lord to plant a church there, and we did. The problem with the community center is they had community kind of events once, sometimes twice a month. They would have a bike-a-thon or they'd have a swim meet or where we couldn't use a facility. So what we would do is pack up our church and go down to the beach and meet under a tent because there was nowhere else to meet. And that was okay, but it was like always telling people we're on the move. Yeah, we're here this week, but next week, so it wasn't ideal. So we wanted to apply to get into Kailua High School. At the time, the principal at Kailua High School was dead set against a church meeting in Kailua High School. And she had her reasons for it that you can agree or disagree with. But that was the obstacle. That was the mountain to be moved, was if we had a more consistent meeting place. And we literally, friends, we prayed our way into Kailua. God had to change her heart. And yet it was a great miracle. God removed that and we were able to meet in Kailua High School, and that was awesome and gave us relationships in the high school community, and we were blessed by that faith that saw God move a mountain. That was one of the highlights. And then later the intermediate school opened up, and then later this church opened up for us to rent on Sunday mornings, and that's been a path of blessing all the way along. But there are times where God will allow an obstacle, something that's way beyond your control that you have no power over, and he says, trust me, pray unwaveringly. And so I would ask you again, what are you trusting for in your life right now that is way beyond your control, that's a God thing? What obstacle needs to be removed perhaps for God's will on earth in your life? And yes, we prayed for Ukraine this morning, and we should continue to pray for Ukraine, just that those things that are way beyond our control, just pray unwaveringly, pray believingly that God is going to move and bring a restraint to that evil and peace in that country, and protection for innocent lives and blessing for Christians. Just keep praying that. That's one sign Jesus teaches us. This is the kind of the fruit of faith. This is the essential commodity of faith that I'm looking for, the essential fruit in my followers. It wasn't there in the temple, but I want it there in the lives of Haumāna, those who are following me, those who are my disciples, my apprentices. Here's the second one. Trust God without wavering. Secondly, pray expectantly. Pray expectantly. What does Jesus say? He says this in verse 24. Whatever you ask for in prayer, here's authentic faith. Believe that you have received it. Pray expectantly, and it will be yours. Now, this is a powerful aspect of prayer. Pray expecting that God is going to answer your prayer. That's authentic faith. That's genuine faith. One of the ways that we can pray expectantly, because what enters into my mind is, you know, the old song, "Oh Lord, won't you give me a Mercedes Benz?" Well, is that really what, you know, that's the kind of things we tend to pray for, right? And God cares about our physical needs and all our needs. But the question is that really what God wants for our lives? And so we need to understand Jesus' teaching and the broader teaching of what Jesus himself, we pray expectantly, but we always pray according to God's will. According to God's will. Remember what Jesus, we looked at it in his teaching on prayer. He says, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your rule on earth. Your will be done." We pray for his will. And we always submit our will into his will. And so I've got that text there in your notes. John was there, one of the original Haumāna, one of the original disciples. And he says this, "This is the confidence." This is how we can pray with confidence in approaching God, that if we ask anything, what? According to his will. We always submit our will to his will. And I hope you've realized that God is much smarter than you. He's much more wise than you. I thought about it this last week. I could tell you two specific things I prayed for in these last 3 years that affected our ministry, that affected my life and my family's life. And I felt this was the right thing to pray for. I thought it was a good thing to pray for, and I prayed unwaveringly, and I prayed expectantly, and God said, "No, that's not what I'm doing." And I look back and I say, "Thank you, God, that you were wiser than me." I'm actually thankful that he didn't answer my prayer. I wonder if you can have had some experience where you end up being thankful that God didn't answer your prayer. Why? Because you submit your prayer to his will. He knows better than you. He knows better than me. He's wiser than me. He sees things that you and I don't see. So we might even have a conviction and pray unwaveringly and pray, but you always pray under the umbrella, if you will, of God's will. And can I just mention one specific thing? And many of you as church family know this and appreciate your prayers. Last fall, my wife Martha was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. And we prayed and had the church pray, and we're praying expectantly and we're praying unwaveringly that God would heal her. He hasn't healed her yet. We continue to pray unwaveringly and persistently that God would strengthen her physically in her body. And so we are living out, seeking to live out what Jesus is teaching us about authentic faith. But we also submit that to God's will, because we realize, and you may have health situations, family with health situations, you pray unwaveringly, you pray expectantly, but you also pray that God's will be done, whatever that may be. And we see this with the Apostle Paul. He prayed continually for healing in his life. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And God said, "Here's my answer to your prayer, Paul. I want you to know that my grace is sufficient for you, and I'm not going to heal you." Now, we want Martha to be healed. We're praying for God's healing, but we also have to say, "God, your will be done in our lives." And that's part of an authentic faith, too. It's not like he's just some sort of slot machine in heaven where you just keep putting in the things and suddenly it's going to... No, you submit. You pray expectantly, you pray unwaveringly for healing, for blessing, for life, but you also accept that God's will has other purposes in our lives that are for his glory and also ultimately for our blessing. So yes, Jesus is saying this is the essential fruit I want to see in your life. What are you praying for? What are you trusting God with without wavering? What are you praying expectantly according to God's will? And then thirdly, he says this. This is authentic faith. Forgive generously. Forgive generously. Jesus says this when he's teaching his disciples. He says, "I don't see any of this faith in the temple, but I want to see it in your lives. I want to see this authentic faith. When you stand praying as a disciple, have a clear heart. Have a pure heart. Don't have grudges. Don't have bitterness. Don't have resentment in your heart. Forgive. Be freed from that. Have a clear heart. When you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive your sins." Because there's a direct relationship between your heart and your relationship with God the Father. And so Jesus says this. Here's a sign of authentic faith. Forgive generously. And I know that's hard. I know that from my own life. I don't know what you've had to forgive in life. It may be family things, it may be business things, it may be personal things. Someone has hurt you. And Jesus is saying, here's authentic faith. Let it go, forgive them. And we saw a couple weeks ago, that's one of his signs for us. He says, love others as I have loved you. How does he love us? With a forgiving love. With a forgiving love. He gave his life to forgive you your sins. He gave his life to forgive me. And he says, now just take some of that forgiving love and share it with the people in your life. And that's authentic faith. And Jesus tells a parable. We mentioned it a couple weeks ago, but let me just mention it again because this is really the key. How do you have that authentic faith that you can actually forgive people and not hold it against them and not hold a grudge and not hold bitterness and not hold resentment, but have a heart that's pure and clean and free from all of that junk? The key is, and Jesus tells a story, that you realize how much God has forgiven you. How much God has forgiven you. And Jesus tells a story, and I'll tell it really quickly. Matthew chapter 18. It's like a guy who went to a king, and he owed the king, catch this, $12 billion. If you crunch the math, the text Jesus told the story, he said 10,000 talents. If you do the work of translating into modern day finances, $12 billion. What's the point of that? The point of that is you could never pay it off. You could work your whole lifetime. You could never pay off $12 billion. I mean, many of us here in Hawaii know what it's like to have a high mortgage. You'd never pay off a mortgage of $12 billion. But the king takes mercy on this guy who has a debt that he could never pay. That's the point. It was a debt he could never pay off. And he says, you're free. I'm just going to let it go. You're off the hook for $12 billion. So the guy goes out and he finds his fellow servant. And the fellow servant owes him, guess what? $20,000. That's the translation. That's not a light sum of money, $20,000, but you can pay that off. You can pay off 20 grand. I'd love to have a mortgage of 20 grand. Raise your hand if you'd like a mortgage in Hawaii of 20 grand. I see a lot of hands out there. You can pay that off. It's a payable debt, right? 12 billion you could never pay off. 20 grand you can pay off. But you know what the servant does in Jesus' story? The servant, having been forgiven 12 billion, is unwilling to let the guy off the hook for 20 grand. And it makes the king very angry, and rightfully so. And here's the point of Jesus' story, speaking life into our lives. Realize, Rick, that I've forgiven you $12 billion worth, all of your sins, your entire life, everything you've done wrong, everything you've thought wrong, everything you should have done that you didn't do, all of your failures in life, all of that's covered by the cross of Jesus Christ. Now, having been forgiven everything, you don't have the right to hold a grudge against someone that has hurt you in some way. And not to minimize those things. I know some of us, our families have hurt us. Friends have hurt us. Some of us have experienced betrayal. But Jesus is saying, I want you to be free of all that. I want you to let it go and love people. And forgiving people doesn't mean that you necessarily trust them again. Trust has to be rebuilt. And yet it does mean that you act towards them as if it never happened. That's really what forgiveness is, that you can be kind to them, that you can be patient, you can love them in the sense of maybe not having warm, fuzzy feelings towards them, they've hurt you, but you can act towards them as if that never happened. That's letting it go. That's forgiving and allowing the peace of God to come into our hearts. And Jesus says, this is a vital part of being a follower of mine, is to love people with the forgiving love that I have for you. And when you stand and pray to God to have a clear heart, and not be taking any junk in your heart as you approach your Father in heaven, but realizing the depth of his forgiving love for you so that you actually spill over and don't hold grudges and resentment and bitterness against other people, but you can just let it go. And by the way, if I can add one other comment, forgiveness takes time. It takes healing, especially the more deeply hurt you are. You don't just one forgiving prayer and it's gone. It's continually making that decision to let it go. And then over time, healing does come. And you find yourself maybe seeing that person and not clenching your fists or having ugly thoughts, but saying, you know what? Out of compassion, I'm going to be kind to that person. I'm going to be patient to that person. I'm going to seek what's best for that person. That's the kind of love that Jesus' love flows into our hearts, even towards those who may never go, they might go to their deathbed never even realizing or never even confessing that they have hurt you, that they've done wrong. Forgiveness isn't dependent upon them coming to grips with their own failure or their own sin. Forgiveness is really about your heart and letting it go, whatever has happened. Jesus says this, This is the fruit of faith. This is authentic faith that I'm looking for in my disciples. And he wants it in your life. He wants it in your home. He wants it in my life, our home. He wants authentic faith that is trusting God for God things without wavering, that is expectant in our prayer, looking for God's will in its fullness. And yes, forgiving generously, having been loved and forgiven. It's like we've been forgiven the Pacific Ocean. We need to forgive a bucket's worth to somebody else who may have hurt us. And so let me close our time this morning by just asking you two questions. Number one is this: are you trusting God for your salvation, for your forgiveness of sins? Because that's the foundation of faith. Jesus came to give his life so that when we put our trust in him, our faith in him, what he did on the cross to die for our sins and to rise again, it's Jesus who makes that promise of forgiveness of sins and eternal life. And that's authentic faith. Initially to say, Jesus, I trust you. I recognize there's these failures, there's these sins in my life, and I need the forgiveness that you offer me through the cross. And I trust that what you suffered on the cross brings forgiveness and eternal life for my. That's a personal decision. You can be a part of a family, you can be a part of a church, but Jesus looks at that fruit of faith in your own life. Only you can make that decision. And can I just say, we're going to close our time in prayer. This might be the morning where one or two of us might just say, you know, I've been sort of like the car parked in the garage, but I've never, I've shown up at church, I've gone along with it, but I've never made that personal decision. Can I encourage you to make that personal decision? We're not going to put you on the spot, but God sees your heart, and there's an opportunity to say, Jesus, this is the day I want to put my faith in you as my Savior, the one who died on the cross for my sins, who rose again, who's coming again. I want to belong to you. I want to trust you. That's authentic faith that will bring you into a whole new relationship with God and change the trajectory of your life and your future for eternity. And then the second part is for those of us that have received Christ and put our faith in Christ. What are the God things that we're trusting for him now? And Martha and I have ours. What are the things that God has laid on your heart that you're just trusting him that are God things, but you're asking him and he's saying, trust me without wavering, trust my goodness, trust my power, trust my wisdom, trust me expectantly with an authentic faith. And yes, clear out your heart, have a forgiving, generous heart towards others, because that's the authentic faith that he teaches his disciples. This is the fruit of faith I'm looking for. I'm not looking for barren trees. I'm looking for the fruit and the fruit of faith in your life and in my life. Let's stand together and look to the Lord and pray together as a church family that the Holy Spirit would stir this kind of faith in deeper ways in our lives. Father, we bow before you, and this is really an amazing passage, Jesus. We see the one occasion where you actually speak a curse of death. But Lord, we know that in that out of character event, that you want us to be those who demonstrate a life of fruitfulness, and particularly in the area of faith. Thank you, Jesus, for this teaching of faith. I just want to pray for any brother and sister who's here this morning in the church building or maybe online, that maybe this is their day. I just want to encourage each one of us to say, Jesus, I put my trust in you for my relationship with you, for the forgiveness of sins, for the gift of eternal life, for the gift of the indwelling spirit. Lord, all of these are your gifts. When I say thank you, Jesus, that you died on the cross for my sins and that you rose from the dead. I want to trust you with that. I want to be unwavering in looking to you for my salvation. Thank you, Jesus, for the heart of love that reaches out to each one of us with that gift, that priceless gift. And yes, Lord, as we search our hearts and realize that you are looking for the fruit of this authentic faith in our lives, would you strengthen us by your Spirit to trust you for God things, to trust you to move mountains, and to have that unwavering trust that doesn't doubt in our hearts, that looks to you, that prays expectantly, and yet knows that you are wiser than we are, and submits even our unwavering, expectant faith to your wisdom, to your goodness, to your love. And yes, Lord, help us, as you have richly forgiven us, may we be generous in forgiving others as well. So, Lord, would you be pleased as you look on our lives, as you look on our church, that you would see that fruit of faith that you looked for in the temple, that you're looking for in our lives. We love you. We serve you this day in Jesus' name. And the Lord's people said, Amen. Go in faith. Have a blessed week. And we will see you Tuesday night.
Aloha, church family. Thank you so much for joining with us in worship this morning. We truly hope that you were refreshed and strengthened in your faith during these crazy pandemic days. We invite you to look at all of our messages. They're available on our YouTube channel. We'd also invite you to download our church app. It's just a great way for us to keep in touch, to communicate, also for you to receive materials. So take advantage of downloading that church app. We would invite you to partner with us as we continue serving God faithfully during these days. And you can give online, you can give on our website, or mail a check into our street address. We really appreciate your support with that. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord turn his face upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord grant you peace. We love you. Aloha.